Good afternoon. Today we continue our lesson about detection and digital communication. In last lecture, we mentioned about the presentation of a signal as a vector. And we said that representing signals as vectors makes the detection easier, because then we can measure the distance between the received signal and the possible transmitted symbols, because every symbol could be represented as a vector. Today, we study the detection process of binary system, and then we show the concept of distances and vectors in this binary system. So in the binary system, the received signal is I of t, could be either S1 or S0, depends on the transmitted symbol, because we have binary now. So it could be binary 0, then we send S0 of t, or binary 1, we send S1 of t. The change of the symbol, it can be in the transmitted signal frequency, or in phase, or magnitude, and so on, as we will see later. Okay, the received signal will be the transmitted one convolved with the channel impulse response, which is time varying, as we studied last week, plus the additive noise. Okay, and this I now, because it's binary, so it could be 0 or 1. Okay, we mentioned the impact of the channel impulse response. Could be represented by multi-backers and also time-varying linear system, but we will study this later. Today, we will consider that we have perfect channel, means that it will not change anything of the transmitted signal. Okay, there's no corruption, and there's no distortion of the transmitted signal. Then, in that case, the received signal will be Si of t, the transmitted signal, plus the additive noise. Means that, because if we look back to this general form, that the received signal is the transmitted signal convolved with the impulse response of the channel. And now, if the received signal is I of t without this point, means that the ideal impulse response to the channel will, when it is direct delta. When it is direct delta, we will have the perfect or the ideal situation. So the answer for this, that HT of and tau is direct delta. Okay, so now this is the received signal. Then we make the recovery and the demodulation. So the transmitted signal now is I of t. It will be collected, of course, there will be additive noise here. And then we make frequency downward conversion, the demodulation process. Then we have the receiving filter, as we will see later, what we mean by receiving filter. Then we have the equalizing filter. Also, we'll study this equalizing filter, that it is used to mitigate the inter-symbol interference, which is one of the impact of the real channel, but we will talk more about this later. Then we take sample at the end of the duration of the symbol. Then, based on that sample, Z of t, we make a threshold comparison, because we have only binary system. We have either S0 or S1. Then we need to have some threshold to say that is it S0 or S1. Okay. After the demodulation process, we assume that the received Z of t, the sampled Z of t, is equal to Ai of t plus the noise sampled N0 of t capital. So the t capital is the sampled version, because we take sample, as you can see, we make a decision at the end of the symbol time. At the end of the symbol time, we make a decision. What about the transmitted symbol? So this will be the received samples in of t, or the value equal to ai of t plus n0 of t. Now, although that ai of t, which can be a0 or a1, is known at the receiver, because it is now, this is a transmitted sample and we know it, okay? But this noise is unknown. We know the statistics of the noise. We know that the noise is Gaussian, zero mean, and it has some average power or values. But we don't know the exact value of the noise. Noise is generated either internally through the receiver itself, because as we mentioned before, that every element or every component in the receiver generates noise. Like every conductor, every resistor has thermal noise, and also every semiconductor it has shot noise. So we have several kinds of noises that summing up to have Gaussian distribution noise. And we have nothing to do with this one. This one is already there, okay? And we should try to find the optimum threshold value in the presence of this noise, okay? And also, not only this, but also we need to know what is the impact of this noise over the probability of error. Okay, so this noise is Gaussian, or random variable, and it has zero mean, and it can be represented by this function, or this probability density function. So we can see that it is 1 over sigma 0, this is the standard deviation, square root 2 pi, exponent of minus n0 squared, because it is zero mean. It is zero mean, and divided by 2 sigma 0 squared. Sigma 0 squared is the variance of the average power of the additive noise. Okay, if we know this is the distribution of the noise, what will be the distribution of that in this case? What does mean? The additive, this n0 is Gaussian with zero mean, and it is added to this ai of t. Ai of t has only two values, either a0 or a1. Okay, it is deterministic. It can be a0 or a1. And this will be z of t. What will be the distribution of z of t in this case?
Gaussian,
yes. And what is the mean?
Zero.
The mean is ai. The mean of the, because this is Gaussian, this is deterministic, okay, and this is z. So the distribution of z, assume that ai equal to 1. Okay, then we have here 1 a plus additive noise, Gaussian noise with zero mean. The result here of 1 plus zero mean Gaussian noise will be Gaussian, but the mean is 1. The mean now is 1, is not 0 anymore, because we have already here 1. If this value is minus 1, then again the distribution of z will be Gaussian, but the mean is minus 1, because this one, this n0, is 0 mean. Zero mean. So here it will be shifted, the distribution of z will be also Gaussian, but it will be shifted by this value here. Okay, so in general, you can do this on the board. In general, if we have, let's say, z, as we said, now is equal to, let's say it is 1 a plus noise, and this noise is n0, and it is normal noise with zero mean and various sigma 0 squared, for example. Okay. When you add anything to Gaussian, the result is Gaussian. Any linear operation for Gaussian will generate also Gaussian. Any linear operation for Gaussian signal will generate also Gaussian. Okay. And this addition is linear operation. So the distribution of z will be also Gaussian, because n0 is Gaussian. Okay, now let us see what will be the mean of z. The mean of z, expected value of z equal to the expected value of 1 plus n0. And we can distribute the expectation inside. So it will be expected value of 1 plus expected value of n0. What is the mean of n0? As we said, it is zero mean. So this value is zero. Then the mean of z equal to 1. Equal to the same as the shift here. Okay? So when you have fixed or deterministic value added to zero mean Gaussian, the result will be Gaussian with this mean. The mean is 1. Okay? And this Gaussian will have also the same variance as the variance of the noise. Okay. Now we can have the conditional distribution. Now the distribution of Z, if the transmitted was S1, will be 1 divided by sigma 0 by square root 2 by exponent, and you can see here it is Gaussian but shifted by A1. So A1 is the mean. Is A1 is the mean. If the transmitted was S0, again it would be the same but shifted by A0. So it depends on the value added to the Gaussian here. Okay. If we draw both of distributions, we have Gaussian distribution, but this is for S0, and now it is not zero mean anymore. Now it is shifted, so the mean is A0, as you can see, and we have another Gaussian with mean A1. With mean A1. Okay. So we have here some threshold. This is the received signal, Z. Now this is the received signal, Z. Okay? Now we have to define some threshold. If the signal is greater than this threshold, then our decision will say that the transmitted was A1 or S1. If the received signal is less than this threshold, then it is most likely to be the transmitted was S0. Okay. Now we need to find what is the optimum threshold in this case. Actually, we can do that before we continue. This z of t, if it is greater than some threshold, we take hypothesis 1. What is hypothesis 1? That the transmitted signal was S1. Okay? If the received signal is less than some threshold, we take the hypothesis 2. Hypothesis 2 is we say that the transmitted signal was S0. Okay, because we have binary, so we have either S0 or S1. We don't have more. Okay, then it becomes easier. We need just some threshold to say which one was transmitted. Okay, but what under what criteria we can build this this decision? One criteria that by minimizing the probability of error or maximizing the probability that our decision is correct. Okay, okay. How can we do that? Simply, the probability, because we have either S1 or S0, we don't have more. Then, if the probability that the transmitted was S1, okay, greater than the probability that the transmission was S0, then we take hypothesis 1. And this is very logical. If the probability that the transmitted was S1, of course, condition on what? On the received statistic. Because now we have Z, based on this Z that we have. Condition, here it is conditional probability. If, based on the Z that we have, now we receive Z. We don't see what was the transmission. Was it zero or this one? We don't know. But we have only the statistic, receiving that Z. This Z that we have, based on the Z that we receive, if the probability that the transmitted was S1 or greater than the probability was S0, of course we will select S1. If the probability that S0 based on the received signal Z is greater than the probability of S1 given Z, it is very logical to select S0. It depends on the probability. Okay, let us do then the next step. Once we have this probability, I just remind you by one conditional probability relation, if you remember, probability of A given B equal to what? Probability of A and B divided by probability of B. This is a conditional probability. And we say also in the first lecture, if you still remember, that this is equal to probability of B given A times probability of A divided by. So this is, we call this as Bayes theorem. Of Bayes theorem. This is probability of A given B equal to probability of B given A times probability of A divided by probability of B. We can do the same actually here in this situation. Now what we have? We have probability of S1 given Z. Let us see what this is. Probability of S1 given Z is equal to by applying the same rule. Now we can change the order. But remember, Z here is continuous, is not discrete anymore, because here we say probability, because we have either S1 or S0. But Z here is continuous, is Gaussian. Okay? So instead of using probability, we use the probability function. So it is F of Z given S1. But we follow the same rule that we have in conditional probability. Multiplied by probability of S1. It's like this one. Okay? Divided by, now we should put this probability of B, but Z again is a distribution, because it's continuous. So we put here F of Z. Okay? So probability of S1 given Z, it can be defined as the distribution of S of Z given S1 times probability of S1 divided by distribution of Z. It could be defined in this way. Okay? Now, based on this one, we can just substitute in the same equation here. So it becomes like F of Z given S1 times probability of S1 divided by F of Z greater than or less than, we did the same as we did in the slide, hypothesis 1, hypothesis 2, then it becomes F of Z given S0 times the probability of S0 divided by F of Z. Okay? We need to build our decision based on this inequality. If this one is greater, we take S1 as transmitted. If this one was greater, we take S0 as transmitted one. Okay? But you can see that if Z here and if Z here the same. So it will not affect the inequality because it will be the same. So simply we can just remove them together. Then we have this relation now with the board. So we have F of Z given S1 times probability of S1 greater than or less than F of Z given S0 times probability of S0. Okay? Then we can divide both sides by F of Z given S0 and also both sides by probability of S1. Then we will have this equation now, this relation. Okay, let us see one step more. We know that the F of Z given S1 is equal to 1 divided by square root 2 pi times the standard deviation sigma S0 times exponent of minus Z minus A1 squared divided by 2 sigma 0 squared. This will be the distribution as we showed before. Now we need to divide given S1 and also by that one given S0. So it means that we divide those together. So we divide it in this way. So I will try to make it step by step to make it clear for you. So we divide it by square root 2 pi sigma 0 and also by E minus Z minus A0 squared divided by 2 sigma 0 squared. So we can see that this comes with one. And we can take this up and it becomes with different sign. So we have here e to the power divided by 2 sigma 0 c squared. But we will have here minus z minus a1 c squared, and this becomes plus z minus a0 c squared. So what we need here is just to expand those two, and then what we get after solving this, but you can do it, it is just one step of math manipulations, and then we find what is the value of z, and we can find that this z of t should, if it is greater than this value, remember that when you have here is exponent, and this will have greater than or less than, and we have here probability of S0 divided by probability of S1. How can you get rid of this exponent, E? By taking natural logarithm for both sides. So this is why we have ln here. Okay? When you take ln for both sides, then you will have here like minus Z minus A1 C squared plus Z minus A0 C squared divided by 2 sigma 0 C squared, greater than, less than, and here you have ln of P of S0 divided by P of S1. This is just to show from where this ln comes, the natural ln. Okay, now we have, this is our threshold. So this is our threshold value. This is our threshold value. If the received statistics Z is greater than this value, then we take hypothesis 1, which means that the transmitting was S1. If it is less, we take the other one, which is, we say that it is S0. If the probability of transmitting is 0 is equal to the probability of transmitting S1, means that this is the a priori probabilities, means that the source itself, the probability of S0 equal to 0.5. Because in the source, we have either probability of S0 or probability of S1. So if one of them is 0.5, then the other one will be also 0.5. And in that case, it will be ln of 1, and ln 1 equal to 0. So this will be 0, and then our threshold will be A1 plus A0 divided by 2, as we can see here. Please correct this one. This will be A0, not A2. Okay? Just this one should be A0. So it is A1 plus A0 divided by 2, and this will be the threshold. Okay, what it means? It means that if, for example, A1 equal to 1 volt and A0 equal to minus 1 volt, for example, then sigma 0 equal to 1 minus 1 divided by 2, and this will be 0. So our threshold will be 0. If our signal received Z is if Z at the end of the simple time is greater than 0, we decide that the transmission was A1. If it was less than 0, then we decide that the transmission was based on A0. Okay, this will be our threshold in this case. If A1 equal to, for example, 2, and A0 equal to 1, in this case, our threshold, it will be 2 plus 1, 3 divided by 2. So it will be 3 divided by 1.5. If the signal is greater than 1.5, we say that it was A1 or the other was A0. So this is the way that we prove that this is the threshold. This threshold will minimize the probability of error, but it will not eliminate it. So still we have error. Because, okay, let us see to this distribution. If you receive this signal, it means that you receive it here. Your Z was in this point, okay? It is clear that it is greater than the threshold, so it is most likely it will be according to the transmission was S1, okay? Because you sent A1, so it might, because of the noise, you might receive it here. If we don't have noise at all, if you sent A1, you will receive A1. It will be only one point here. If you receive A0, you will receive, if you transmit A0, you will receive A0. If we assume perfect ideal system, there is no additive noise, there is no impact of the channel. So if you send A1, you will receive A1. If you send A0, you will receive A0. But because of the noise and the channel problems, you send A1, you will the probability that you send A1 and you receive exactly A1 is probability zero. Okay? Because of the noise. There is additive noise. So the noise is continuous. So according to the noise, you might receive more than A1 or less than A1. And you send A1. Okay? But if you receive the signal close to A1, close enough to A1, then it is logical to say that most likely the transmitted symbol was A1. Is it always? Is it necessary? No. Because of the noise, maybe you sent A1 and the noise was strong enough to take that you receive it somewhere here. And even you sent A1 and you receive it somewhere here. But what is the probability that will happen? The probability that will happen, we make the integration over this blue one, and to take the integration, that the received signal will be from minus infinity up to some value here, which is very small probability. It can happen, but with very small chance. And now we build our detection based on the maximizing the probability of correct detection. Okay? But still we need to calculate what is the probability of error in this optimal receiver. The probability of error, what is the probability of error that you sent S1 is the same as the probability that you select hypothesis 2 because the transmitted was S1. And given the transmitted was S1. And what that means? Means that you take the integration from minus infinity up to alpha 0 is our threshold f of z given S1. Let us make it easier by looking to the figure. So the probability that you sent A1, what will be the probability of error? The probability of error, if you sent A1, if the received signal was less than alpha 0, the probability of error, if you sent A1, is equal to, or it happened, what is the chance that you sent A1 and you receive a signal to be less than the threshold? Because if it is less than the threshold, we will select A0. Okay, how to calculate this probability? Simply, we have the distribution, the blue line that you can see, the blue curve, and then we take the integration from minus infinity to the threshold for this blue curve, which means that the area under the tail in this blue curve, this would be the probability of error. Okay, if the transmitted symbol was A0, means that it was S2, A0, or S0. What is the probability that you will receive it in error? This will happen if you send A0, but your Z was greater than the threshold. Is it clear? Okay, what is the probability that the receiver is greater than this threshold? You look now for the green curve, and we take the integration of from the threshold until infinity for this, the blue, for the green curve. So this will be the probability of error in that case, okay? And the total probability of error, because we have the probability of error, if you send S0 and you receive it as S1, or plus, or you send it as, you send S1 and you send it as S0, okay? So the probability of error will be the probability of error given you send S1, times probability that you're sending S1 plus probability that you have error given that it was zero was transmitting, times probability that you transmit S0. Yes, please.
Aren't those two things the same? Are they like
exactly. They are the same if we have like, because the Gaussian is first symmetric.
Yes.
And also if those probability are 0.5, 0.5. If the probability of sending zero equal to the probability of sending one. And this is usually the case, actually. Okay? If not, of course, you cannot say that they are equal in that case. But if they are 0.5, 0.5, and those are Gaussian, the Gaussian is symmetric distribution, so those will be the same. And in that case, it is enough to take one of them, not necessary to evaluate both cases. So then the probability of error is, if we take, for example, for the first one, as I explained just now, the integration of minus infinity up to the threshold, okay, of the distribution of z given s1, and it is the same if we take the integration from alpha 0 up to infinity for the distribution which has the green curve. This is the blue curve and this is the green curve. You can take only one of them. Okay? And now when we make the integration, so we have it like the integration from this alpha 0 up to infinity, and we substitute with this given s0, and this will be exponent because this will be shifted by a zero, and this is the green curve in the figure. Okay? Now if we make some change of variables, that we put u equal to z minus a0 divided by sigma 0, then we can put this form in the q function form. So it is exactly the q function form that we have seen in the first part. So this will be the q function of a1 minus a0 divided by 2 sigma 0. Okay, so the probability theorem, and this is the reason that when we cover the first part, we have some like attention about this q function, because the q function it represents the probability of error. It gives us the curve or the area under tail of the distribution function, of the Gaussian distribution function, and this is the probability of error. Okay, you can see here a1 minus a0 is what? Is the distance. A1 minus a0 is the distance between a1, the first transmission, and the second transmission. This is in case of binary system. So in binary system, the vectors will be on the x-axis only. So if you have, this is the line, so we have here like a1 and here we have here a0. What is the distance between a1 and a0? Is a1 minus a0. This will be the distance between a1 and a0. Okay? So this will be the distance, and now this is the q function. By computing this q function, you can easily calculate the probability of error in the binary system. Okay. You can see that the probability of error depends on the distance and depends also on the standard deviation of the noise. Actually, the distance is related to what? The power of the signal, as we will see it later. But now, let us define some performance measure for digital communication. Okay, usually in communication we use the signal to noise ratio. We say that all the time signal to noise ratio. Signal to noise ratio is the signal power divided by the noise power. So we say that signal to noise ratio is an R equal to the average received power, okay, divided by the average noise power. This is usually in communication. If you have signal with binary phase shift keying, the binary phase shift keying, it means that the signal it has only like for example here A and minus A. So this could be represented by A cosine 2 pi ft, and A could be for example plus or minus 1. So we have here for example, plus 1 or minus 1. So A could be plus or minus 1. This is binary phase shift keying. What is the average power of this signal? The average power is A squared divided by 2. Okay? It is sinusoidal signal. So the average power is A squared divided by 2. If the plus and minus 1 are equally like. Okay. Now, if we have like 8 phase shift, 8 and 8 phase shift key, which means that now we don't have AI anymore, but we have the phase shift, which the phase can be shifted 8 times. Okay, now it can be, we might send this one, or this one, or this one. Have one 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So now we have 8 possible transmissions. Every transmission, we might send 3 bits now, because we have 8 different symbols, and every symbol now it has different phase. So we have, for example, this is the first one, the phase 0, and we have phi 1, phi 2, and so. So by changing the phase, we can change which symbol is transmitted. Okay? If the symbols are equally likely, now remember, now for every time you send 3 bits, for example, this is 0, 0, 0, for example, 0, 0, 1, and so on. So for every phase transition, we send 3 bits. By this way, we can triple the bit rate. The bit rate in the binary without increasing power. Without increasing power, by, for example, the binary case, if we send 1 megabit per second, by switching to this 8 array phase shift key, we start to send 3 megabit per second without increasing power. But what's the cost now? The average power is still the same, a squared divided by 2. But looking here, you can see that the distance becomes shorter. Because in the first case, this was the distance, very large distance. It means that the probability of error is small. But now, the distance becomes shorter. When the distance is shorter, the probability of error will increase. Because it is more likely that you send this one and you receive it here. Because you send, for example, 0, 0, 0, maybe you will receive it here. And then you think that it is closer to this one, and you have this one, in this symbol instead of that correct one. But if we send only 2 symbols, if you receive it here, we still say that it is the same. Okay? Now, by looking only to the average power of the transmitted symbol, we don't see this fact. Because the power in both cases, in the binary phase shift key case, and now in this 8 array phase shift key, the signal power is the same. The signal power is the same. And then the SNR will be the same value. S over N will not be changing. So this is tricky. The signal to noise ratio is not good measure for the quality in digital communication. The SNR as it is in this way. So we need to modify it a little. Okay. Now how could we modify? One way, that by using the energy per bit. The energy transmitted per bit. So what is the energy? The energy equal to the power multiplied by time. Okay? So if we multiply this average power by the bit duration, TD, this is the duration, the time duration per bit. Now this equal to what? The energy per bit. But we cannot divide energy by power. Usually in the measure, when you measure some criteria, you have to use the same unit. So it is energy and divided by the energy. And in that case, we have the noise power, but the noise power, we can divide it by the bandwidth of the system, so W. So noise power divided by the bandwidth gives you the energy spectral density. So the energy in the noise side. And here, the energy in the bit. So it becomes EB over N0. It is called EB over N0. The energy bear bit bear the noise spectral density. Okay? So this would be S times T0 times divided by N, the noise power, divided by W. Okay? And now this W can be up here. So we have S and this T0 divided by N, sorry, and this T0, TB, is 1 divided by the bit rate, because the bit rate equal to 1 divided by the bit duration. So this would be like W divided by RB. So this is called EB over N0. This is very important, actually. It's very important digital communication. Very important. So you can see now, S over N, if we apply it here, to the example that I show now. In the binary case, we have RB and we have W. Okay? Assume that W is the same as RB. Okay? Then we have EB over N0 is the same as S over N. It is the same. But when you switch from binary to 8 array base shift keying. It means that you increase the bit rate 3 times. Okay, when you increase the bit rate 3 times, what happens? Then S over N will be divided by 3, which means that EB over N0 will be lower. EB over N0 will be lower, and this is actually logical, because when you increase the data rate, the bit rate, within the same bandwidth, what you do? Actually, you reduce the bit duration. You reduce the bit duration. When you reduce the bit duration TB, it means that you use less energy per bit. Less energy per bit makes it more, you reduce this tolerance for noise. This will be explained even more later. But now, we use now this EB over N0. You will see it a lot in this course. EB over N0 instead of S over N, the noise ratio. Such kind of graphs are very famous in digital communication. It gives the criteria for a quality measure, and you got here, for example, EB over N0, and you got here the bit error rate. The bit error rate. So as you can see, if you have two coding methods, this green one and the blue one, which one is better here? The green or the blue? The green.
The blue.
The blue. The green. Which one?
The green.
The green. Yeah. Why the green is better? Because the green, you can achieve the same bit error rate at lower EB over N0. Which means it is better. Because to increase EB over N0, it means that you have to increase EB. How to increase the energy per bit? You have two ways to increase the energy per bit. Look to this. EB equal to S times TB. Okay, to increase EB, what you need to do? Either you increase the transmission power or the time. When you increase the time, what means? Exactly. You reduce the bit rate. For example, instead of using 1 megabit per second, I need to use only 10 kilobit per second. So our system becomes very slow. Okay? So, to increase EB, you need either to increase power or to reduce, or to increase TB or reduce data rate. Increasing power is not available always. We have some limit to increase our power. Because increasing power means more interference to others. And if we just increase the power, because I'm just increase the power, everyone else will increase the power. And then we have a high interference and the system will collapse. And also, just increasing TB is not good either, because just increasing TB means that lowering the data rate. Sometimes I am forced to do that, but it is not a good solution, because in this case, to open Facebook, you will need to wait like many hours, okay, because the data rate is very slow. Okay, we take this slide, then we take a break. Now, the probability of error, as we said, it depends on the distance between the transmitted symbols and divided by 2 sigma 0, and sigma 0 is the standard deviation of the noise. But again, it is not good always to deal with such parameters, because A1 and A0 could be voltage and could be current. Okay? It is better always to deal with power or energy. And in that case, we can transfer this to power or energy by looking to the fact that EB, the energy per bit, is equal to half times A1 squared, because we have sinusoidal signal. So this is the average power now, half A1 squared times TB. And it is also the same as half A0 squared times TB. Then we can define A1 and A0 based on the energy per bit. So it is the same here, A1 and A0 could be defined as the energy, voltage or current, in the normalized case. Okay, and now we just substitute A1 and A0 here by the square root of 2EB divided by TB, and we divide it here. So we have here 2 divided by 2 sigma 0. We can take sigma 0 inside the square root when we put it square. So we have here the variance of the noise or the power. The noise. And in case of of the binary case. So we have N0, that noise structure density is sigma 0 c squared divided by the bandwidth of the system. And this is equal to sigma 0 c squared divided, multiplied by TB, because 1 over TB is the same as the system bandwidth in case of modulated binary, modulated like final phase shift key. Binary phase shift key means that we have modulated signal, and we'll see when we talk about Nyquist bandwidth required to avoid inter-signal interference. This will be discussed next lecture. Finally, the probability of error by defining those things, it will be the Q function of square root 2eb divided by n0. Eb over n0, remember, is the energy per bit, okay, and n0 is the noise spectral density. And we have here 2. This will be the probability of error in case of binary phase shifting. Okay, you can take like 10 minutes break and we continue. Thank you. Is 1 of t or is 2 of t? Is 1 represent like binary 1 and this represents binary 0. Okay, so we have 2 symbols that we send each time. You can see here that t, the symbol time, is equal to 3 microseconds for both cases. And actually, is 2 of t is minus equal to minus is 1 of t, as you can see here. So to calculate the probability of error in this case, in system where we have the noise spectral density is given like 10 to the power minus 12 watts per hertz. So what we need to do, as we see here, we need only to calculate the EB, the energy per bit. So the energy per bit here is the integration of S1 of t c squared, okay, which is the power dt. And this will be done this way. So we have EV equal to integration from 0 up to 3 microseconds, V square of t dt. And you can see that we should integrate from 0 to 1. And this will be 1 millivolt square times 1 microsecond plus we take integration from 1 to 2. And the value is 2 millivolt square will be 4 times 10 to the power minus 6. And then I get finally from 2 to 3, as it is shown here. Then the result will be 6 times 10 to the power minus 12 joule. This would be the energy bare symbol, or per bit in this case. Okay, now we just substitute those here in the equation of the calculating the probability of error, and then we have EB is given. And we have N0 was given already in the example, 10 to the power minus 12. And this gives us Q to the power square root of 12. And this will be 2.9 times 10 to the power minus 4. This will be the probability of bit error. OK, the match filters. As we saw before, we call it here receiving filter. What is the purpose of the receiving filter or the matched filter? Okay, the received signal you send in digital communication, we have a finite number of symbols that we send. In binary, we have only 2 symbols. In MRA, we have m different symbols. Okay, so it is, we call it like we send a symbol from finite alphabetic. Okay, binary, we have only 2. In 8 array, we have 8. Okay, 16 array, we have 16. Always we have finite number of transmitted symbols. Those symbols are known at the receiver side. Okay? But the receiver doesn't know which one was transmitted. But they know from the collection of all possible symbols. Okay? When you send this symbol and it is received by the receiver, it will be corrupted by noise. What would be the best filter that it will take the signal as clean as possible? Of course, we cannot avoid the noise completely, but we should be as much as possible to have a clean reception of the signal. Okay. So this is the topic, magic filter. It means that we need to a filter, linear filter, which maximize the output signal to noise switch. Okay. Now we have the magic filter. This magic filter that we need now to study it and to know what is the best impulse response of this filter, or what is the best transfer function of this filter, which makes the output signal to noise ratio as maximum as possible. Okay. The input, we have S of T, which has the frequency transfer function, S of F. Okay, it comes to this magic filter. The output will be AI of T, which is the convolution between S of T and the impulse response of this magic filter, S of T converted with H of T. And in the output in the frequency domain, for example, A of F, is equal to the input in the frequency domain S of F multiplied by the transfer function of the magic filter. Now, our question, what is the optimum H of T or H of F which makes the output signal translation as maximum as possible? Okay, as maximum as possible. Let us see. Now, the signal translation in the output, it can be represented as the output AI of T, because always we are interested to take the time at the end of the time duration of the symbol. So it has been taken at T capital is the time of the symbol, because we are interested by the end of the symbol. We don't take the integration until the middle of the symbol. We should complete the symbol and then we have the decision. Okay. So this is the reason that we take it at the end of the symbol T. So it is AI squared divided by sigma 0 squared. Sigma 0 squared is the average noise power. Okay. We know that AI of T is equal to the convolution between the input and the impulse response. Or it is the inverse Fourier transform of the input S of F times H of F. Let us put in the board. So we have here H of T and it has H of F. We have here S of T and it is transfer Fourier transform is S of F. Okay, and here we have AI of T. Okay, what is AI of T now? AI of T is equal to S of T convolved with H of T, but both of them should be taken at T equal to T capital. Okay? And it can be also as the inverse Fourier transform of what? Of S of F multiplied by H of F. Is it okay? So if you multiply the input in frequency domain by the transfer function, you will have the output in the frequency domain. If you take the inverse Fourier transform, then you will get it in time domain again. So that's all. Okay, the inverse Fourier transform of this multiplication is given in the slide here. You can see H of F times S of F and times E to the power J2 by F T capital, because we take the sample at T capital, DF. So this will be the output AI of T. What about the noise power, output noise power? So the noise power will be N0 divided by 2, multiplied by, because this is the input is white noise, so the input is white noise, which means that it has N0 over 2 as noise spectral density, then it will be multiplied by H of F absolute value squared, as we saw before. So the signal noise ratio now, AI squared, T divided by sigma 0 squared, we just substitute those two here. Now, this integration, the absolute value of this integration can be expanded with Schwarz's or Schwarz's inequality. What Schwarz's inequality says? Schwarz's inequality says for any two functions, f1 of x and f2 of x, they are continuous, f1 of x times f2 of x dx, the absolute value of them, the integration and the absolute value squared, is always less than or equal to, okay, the integration for everyone alone. multiplication. So that this is valid always in by using this Schwarz's inequality, that magnitude value of f1 times f2 all square, because f1 and f2 can be complex. Okay, so we take the absolute value square, is always this value equal to the integration of the absolute value of f1 of x square dx times the integration from f2 of x absolute value square dx. So this inequality is always hot, and the quality, because this always get less than or equal. When it is equal, it is equal if f1 is equal to the conjugate of f2. Okay, if f1 equal to some constant multiplied by the conjugate of f2, in that case, the quality will be hot. Otherwise, it is always less than or equal. Okay, simply now, you can see this factor inequality can be applied here. Okay, let us see. By looking to this integration now, we have the absolute value square. If we expand it with this Schwarz's inequality, we would have here again this than or equal. And we can make this inside. So we would have like h of f absolute value square times s of f times e absolute value square. But we know that the exponent of any complex number is equal to 1, the magnitude value. The e of jx, the magnitude value equal to 1, always. Since it is 1, then this will be disappeared when we distribute the square value inside this integration. Okay? Then we will have here h absolute value square times s absolute value square, as you can see in the next slide. So this will be less than or equal. Okay. Now, this integration from infinity to infinity, h of f square, will cancel the previous one of the noise. Because here we have integration by infinity to infinity, h of f absolute value square. So this one will be cancelled from the above one. Then what we will have this, the sigmoid ratio at time duration t is this then equal to 2 over n0 times the integration from minus infinity up to infinity s of f absolute value square df. Remember that s of t here is the energy signal, because it's finite time. Which means that when you take the integration from minus infinity to infinity, it gives you the energy per symbol. Okay, now this will be this then equal. What it means? It means that the maximum, this sigma plus ratio, the maximum, when this equal to this one. Okay? So the maximum S and R, which can be achieved at the output of the matched filter, will be 2 times the energy bare symbol divided by the noise spectral density, N0. Okay? But, as I said, what Schwarz's inequality says, it says that the quantity, this maximum, will achieve it if one equal to k for any constant times f2 conjugate. What it means? It means that this will be achieved simply if s of f equal to the conjugate of h of f in this way. So s of f should be the conjugate, or in other words, h0 of f should be k times the conjugate of s of f, because as you can see from the original function, this is what we have here. So when this h of f equal to the conjugate of this one, what is the conjugate of this one? It will be s conjugate of f times e, because here we have positive, then we put just the negative sign above. So this will be transfer function of the matched filter. So the matched filter should have this transfer function k. K is any concept, it can be 1, no problem. But it should be the conjugate of the s of f times e times minus j2 by f t times. Okay, what is the impulse response? The impulse response of this filter is just simply by taking the inverse Fourier transform. Taking the inverse Fourier transform for this one, it gives you this result. It will be k constant times s of t is the simple duration minus t. So this will be the impulse response of the best filter. So the best filter for any symbol s of t, I will explain also the physical meaning of this. So the impulse response, if you have s of t, this is your transmitted symbol. Okay. So the best impulse response of this symbol, h of t, should be, this h of t, should be any constant k times s of t minus t. T minus t. Of course, here s of t, remember that s of t is already has a certain time. So it, for example, it is from 0 up to some time t. For example, it can be in this way. This will be, for example, s of t. In that case, the best impulse response of the matched filter will be shifted, but you can see that we have here minus t. What is the, what this means? A flipping. When you have s of t, what is s of minus t? It will be flipped. The flipping of the signal around the y-axis. Okay? It just like mirror. Okay? So now we have minus t, it will be flipped in this way. Then it is shifted by t. So it will be like this one. Okay? Because now it is flipped. Okay? Then it is shifted by t. When it is flipped, this is s of t. S of minus t would be in this way. It is in this way. And here it is minus t. But now it is plus t. You shift it in this way. So it becomes that way. So this is the best impulse response. Okay. What is the physical meaning of this? For example, if you have this mouse, okay, and now you want to design, what is the filter? The filter is gate. It's a gate that this gate should make only this mouse to go through it without any other thing. What is the best shape of the gate? It will be the mouse itself. So if you have a gate which has exactly the same shape of this mouse, to make the mouse only to go through it, it means that nothing will pass through it. But what about the noise inside the mouse? You cannot do anything about that. Clear? So this is the idea of matched filter. The matched filter, you have the signal, okay? I am trying to clean out any noise coming with the signal, outside the signal itself. But the noise inside the signal band, I cannot do anything for that. Okay? But how it will be that the shape of that filter, the best shape of that filter will be related to the shape of the symbol itself. Clear? And this is actually one of the benefits of digital communication, because we have finite number of symbols. In analog, we couldn't do that. In analog, because it might have any shape. Okay, you cannot design shape for every signal, because we have infinite number of shapes of the signals in analog. But in digital, we have finite number of symbols, then we can design optimum filter for every symbol. Okay, this is the way that it comes from. And if we make the convolution now, we convolve the received signal, okay, with the matched filter, okay? And now this is the received signal, r of lambda, because this is the convolution integral, so we make that convolution integral from 0 to t. We have r of lambda times h of t minus lambda. We remove h of t minus lambda, and we put the matched filter, which is s of t minus t, and we remove t and put lambda minus t, so it becomes like s of t capital minus t plus lambda. Okay, we know that always we look to the statistics at t equal to t capital, the end of the duration. So when you put here t capital, so t cancel t, then what we have this will be the opposite. The opposite of t will be k, any constant, time is the integration from 0 up to t, the received signal r of lambda times s of lambda d lambda. What is this? This is actually correlation. This is correlation. This is a correlation of the received signal with the symbol itself. Okay, and this is actually the most important part in this second part of this lecture, that the optimum receiver. The optimum receiver or the matched filter could be achieved by using correlators. And the idea here is that assume that you have four array system of quadratic phase shift keying. So we might send S1 of t, or S2 of t, or S3 of t, or S4 of t. And this represents 0, 0, and this, for example, represents 0, 1, and this 1, 1, and this, for example, 1, 0. Okay? So now we have four possible symbols that we transmit. Okay. During that transmission, the received signal R of t equal to Si, we don't know which one of them, plus noise. Now we ignore the impact of the channel. Plus noise N of t. And every symbol, it has time duration t. A time duration t for every symbol. Okay. What is the best way to do? The best way is to design four matched filters. Every matched filter is matched for one of those symbols. Okay, so it becomes like, okay, we can say that this is the received signal. We can put it this way. So we have matched filter for S1, matched filter for S2, matched filter for S3. S3 and matched filter for S4. Okay. Then we can take again as example at time t from every branch. If the transmitted was S2, if the transmission was S2, then what's coming through the matched filter is only noise. Okay? What's coming through matched filter 2 will be S2 plus noise. And here only noise. And here only noise. Okay? Because every matched filter designed for certain symbol. So, if they are orthogonal each other, it means that if they are orthogonal, then S2 will not pass through S3 because they are orthogonal. So we have only noise if they are orthogonal to each other. And it is possible to make it orthogonal for the quadratic case. Okay? And because of that, we have only, this will be the maximum value. So the maximum that we got, it will be through the part where we have S2. And the others will be, because it is only noise, when we average noise, it will be very small, close to zero. Okay? And we have only this S2. Okay. Now, instead of designing the matched filter, we prove now that the matched filter can be designed as a correlator. So it means that this same circuit can be designed to be in this one, this way. So we have, this is R of T. Okay? Then what I do? I just multiply the received signal with S1 of t, because as I said, in digital communication we know the symbols, but we don't know which one is coming now. Okay, so it is here like the integrator from 0 to t, and then we have the output, then that is 2 of t, the integrator, then the output, and with S3 of t. Then the integrator from 0 to t capital, and we have the output. Then we multiply with S4 of t with the integrator from 0 to t capital, and then cos dt, then we have also the output. Assume now the R of t is equal to, let's say, S3 of t plus n of t. This is L of t now, is equal to S3 of t plus N of t at certain time, at certain time. Then, this S3 of t will be multiplied by S1 of t, okay? And then we take the integration. If S1 of t and S3 of t are orthogonal, when you integrate S1 times S3 will be zero. And we'll have the integration of only of N of t, so we'll have the integration of N of t dt. And this will be small value, because the average of the noise is zero. And here we have integration between S2 and S3. Again, if they are orthogonal, it will be zero. And then we have only the nt here. But here we have the integration of S3 times S3. It will be S3 magnitude square. And this will be large. Cannot be zero now. Cannot be zero because it will be the power of S3 of t plus noise also. Okay? And this will be the output. And for the fourth one, it will be also only noise. So the probability, now you have this output. Let's say we have output 1, output 2, output 3, and output 4. Okay. Now we measure the distance. We measure the distance of those received signals. For example, if all three, if they are all normalized, and all three was the maximum one, then it is most likely that transmitted was S3. Most likely the transmitted was S3, because this gives the maximum one. So this achieved the minimum distance, or the maximum likelihood estimator in this case. Okay? So this is called correlator receiver. This is very important digital communication. Correlator receiver is the basis for the detection in digital communication. It is based on correlating the received signal with all possible symbols. Not necessarily you make the correlation with the symbols itself. You can make the correlation with the basis function. Because we know that it is possible, as we saw before, it is possible to make the projection of the signal over basis. So if we have two basis function, psi 1 and psi 2, for example, and we have different symbols, for example, based on psi 1 and psi 2. So every signal, S of t, could be transmitted like for example, Si could be, for example, Ai1 psi 1 of t plus Ai2 psi 2 of t. In that case, we can make the projection of the received signal over the basis function. And this will be done in this way. Okay, we have here R of t, then we multiply it with psi 1, and we make the integration from 0 to t. Then we also, you can see now it is easier, because only we have, in this case, only two basis function. Then we have only two branches correlator now. And then we have integration from 0 to t, dt. And then we would have here like A, I1 and AI2. What I do now, when I receive this R of t, I make the projection of R of t over psi 1 and psi 2, and then I calculate AI1 and AI2. And in that case, for example, if we have here psi 1, psi 2, assume that your system is, okay, let me change to this plot. Now that we use 16 arrays. 16 array means that we have, for example, this is psi 1 and psi 2. This is like two-dimensional system, but symbols can be here, say, okay, it can be here. we have, this is called the constellation diagram. So every one of those represents transmitting signal. So every one has different magnitude and phase. So every one represents transmitting signal. So for example, we can say that this is zero, is one, for example, is two, is three, is four, is five, is six, is seven, blah. Okay? This was the transmitting plan. Now, the received signal is equal to Si of t plus noise. But remember now, also this noise now is not one dimension. The noise also is two dimension, because the noise, as if you remember, it can be also expanded over psi 1 and psi 2. It is two dimensional noise. So or if we work in the complex plane, then we can say that it is a real and imaginary part. Okay. The same signal now is expanded or is projected over psi 1 and psi 2, as we see. So we have AI1 and AI2. So we might receive it somewhere here. This was the received at certain time t0 after the projection. After the projection, we have this was like AI1 and this was AI2. How can I decide which one was transmitted? By measuring the distance between this received vector with other possible. So vectors or other possible symbols. So you can see this is d1. This distance is d2. Of course, it is clear that the others are far away. So I am more interested in this, either this symbol or this symbol. Which one is closer? Then we take a decision about it. Because we say that this is the maximum likelihood detection, based on the distance. Okay, but how to reach to this point? By using the detection first. So the detection can be done by using this projection of the received signal over the basis function, that psi 1 and psi 2. Better way is to do it in this way. It is better to do it in this way. So the received signal is projected or is matched with every possible symbol. So it is with S1 generator and then with S2 and until we make it with S16 in this case. It is better to do it to match it with every possible symbol. 16 symbol in this case. It might that we have 52 symbols. It is possible to have 128 symbols. It is possible to have 256 symbols. So the receiver can be very complicated and large in this case. So it is better to it is less expensive to do it only with the basis function. With the basis function, we can do it in this way. But for the higher sophisticated receiver, it is better to do it in this one. If it is more complicated, but it will be better. Of course, nowadays it is not that complicated, or it is not that complex, because usually we do that with the DSP. With the DSP, we can program it to do it for any number. So it is possible. So this one, the performance will be better than the projection over the basis as this one. But this one is easier to implement. Then, as it is shown, we take the maximum value signature, for example, for this, and then we can detect the transmitted signal. So this is the way of detecting and deciding which transmitted symbol was. Okay, this is called Leibniz integral rule. We might need it somewhere, so you can keep it in the slide. So here, if you want to differentiate a function as it is, so you have this integration, and we have the function is function in some parameter z and also x, and the limit of the integration is function in some parameter z, and you want to differentiate this function with respect to z. There's some way that you can do it without evaluating this integration. Sometimes because you need here to evaluate the integration before you take the differentiation. But it is also possible with by applying this rule to apply and find the differentiation of this function without performing that integration, like it is shown here. So sometimes if f of x and z is not function in z, so this differentiation will be zero, so we don't need to integrate at all. But maybe we need this later when we talk about simulation theory in some places in this course maybe. So we keep the slide one here. Any questions? Okay, now we have we can say that we have taken some concepts of how to do the detection in digital communication. Digital communication, we have a certain number of symbols, and then we can make a projection of the received signal over the possible phases functions, and then we measure the distance between the received symbol with every possible symbol, and then we take the minimum distance, and this is called minimum or maximum likelihood estimator. And next lecture, we talk how to mitigate the impact of the channel. You can see that in this lecture, we ignore the channel. We say that the received signal is equal to the transmitted signal plus noise. We consider it only noise. But in reality, we have multipath, we have fading, we have problems in the wireless channel. So we need to consider them as well. Okay. So this will be the topic of tomorrow lecture. Tomorrow lecture is at 8 o'clock.
Yes.
Tomorrow. Okay. Thanks a lot.